everyone, this is Rebecca. Welcome to the Art and Needlework Podcast. This is episode 3. It's been a couple weeks since my last podcast. I went into some trouble with my video editing software. I use Corel Video Studio, and because of a Windows update, it became incompatible with the Video Studio version I have, so there was some time where I was trying to figure out what I should do about that, but I got it up and running today, so I thought I should shoot out a podcast. And okay, so I did a lot of different things since I last spoke with you. I did some watercolor, I did some crochet and quilting. So I'll get to all those in a bit, but I just want to share some news with you. I contacted my local yarn store here. It's called the New U. It's located in Newaygo, Michigan. And I've been talking to them. And I am now going to hold my first crochet class on March 5th. So I'm really excited about that. And this is the first time I've held a crafting class, so we'll see how that goes. Because I'm doing a crochet class, I thought it might be a good time for me to pause my Iceland sweater that I was talking to you about in the previous episodes, and to start on another sweater, but this one is going to be crocheted, so I can wear it for the class. So I chose the Garden Party sweater, designed by Marley Bird, and I'll go grab it now. So I'm using the most recently updated pattern. It seems like there were some errors in the one that was, I think it was printed in Love of Crochet magazine, and then they did a retta and updated it. And I have, I hope, the most recently updated pattern. So I chose Knit Picks Gloss Fingering in the Clover colorway, and this is my progress so far. I'm working on the back section first, and I've just started the first row for the arms, the sleeves. So I just wanna show you here to give you a better idea of how is this sweater constructed. I don't know if you can see it in the camera, but it's all done in one piece, which is really helpful when you're trying things on. You know, you can, for instance, if you have this in maybe 1, 2, 3, 5 sections, it might be kind of difficult for you to figure out if you had the correct length, the correct width. This way I can do it as I go along. And unlike knitting, crochet, you do one stitch at a time, so you get to see your work flat all the time. Unlike knitting, where you're working on all your stitches, they're always on the needle, so you can never really, unless you have a very long circular, you never really have the chance to look at your knitting flat on the table. So always helpful to try things on as you go along. But here in the schematic, you can see that here's the back section, and it goes up, and you crochet some chains for the arm, the sleeves, and then you continue that for about 8 inches, and then you start shaping for the neck, and then it starts for the left front, right front. All done in one piece, and then it's folded in half, and then you seam the underarms, and that's it. There is a trim to it. It's kind of like a scallop edge. I don't know if I'm going to do that, because I'd rather have a more simpler design for the for this section here and for the hem, so I might change that design a little bit just because I want a simpler aesthetic. Okay. I'm going to add in this section here a little clip on how I worked the gauge, because I had some gauge issues and I also did some modifications in the length of the sleeve and body of the sweater. So I'm going to add a little clip here to go a little bit more into that. Alright, that was my sweater. Now I'm going to show you some finished objects during the past couple weeks. I finished a baby quilt for my store. I have it up in my Amazon store, so that is amazon.com/handmade/artandneedlework, and there you'll see a baby quilt I made. I also did a few pairs of baby slippers that are reversible, so I'll be showing you that in a bit. And I also did some watercolor painting because I got some new paints and a new paper and palette, so I wanted to try that out. Now, okay, if you've done any bit of quilting, you've probably heard about charm packs. They're a pre-cut like this. Charm packs are made up of 5x5 squares of fabric done in different prints, and they combine it in this pack. This one has 42 squares. They combine it so you get a diverse selection of prints for your quilt without buying yardage. So it's a time saving. It's also more affordable than if you were going to buy half yards or yards of different fabrics. So this is just an example. I bought a charm pack that had prints of animals. So I took the 5x5 squares and I used them to make these slippers, little baby slippers. These are size 3 to 6 months, and I think most of the squares in my 42 pack from Moda, I think most of them had 2 squares of each print, so I was able to just throw in some solid fabric that I had and put the print on the toe area and the solid fabric for the sole and part of the back, the heel. And see, as you can see, it's entirely reversible, so you can turn it inside out, right side out, and you get a whole different look. Like that. And this one has little foxes on it. And this one has ladybugs. The first one I did, I just used some fabric that I had, and I used chambray and stripes. So those are kind of beachy, nautical feel to it. I went on to craftsy.com to buy the pattern for this one, and I believe that they were called reversible baby slippers. They were designed by Mella Designs. That's M-E-L-A. And you can find that on Craftsy and make your own. I got a little bit confused about one step of the pattern. I didn't put the lining of the sole in the right place, so I basically encased my slipper, and I couldn't get it apart. Oh, it was a mess, but I figured it out, so but it was a learning experience. So I bought another charm pack that had pink flowers and blue flowers, and I was going to use them in the making of the slippers, but I thought that maybe I should try making a baby quilt out of them because they really look good together. That one was Kindred Spirits, designed by Bunny Hill for Moda, if you're interested in buying that one. So, this is the quilt I made. I haven't quilted in a very long time. I made a quilt back in 2009. It was my first quilt. I made it for my sister. It was twin size, so it was a pretty big project. And then I made, well, that wasn't my first quilt. Actually, my first quilt was a baby quilt I think I made 2 years prior to that, so there was a time where I was making some quilts and then I stopped and then I'm picking it up again. So here's the quilt I made. As you can see, it has three main colors. It's pink, light blue, and some tan, beige, that sort of thing. I really like it. I added some, I wanted to add some texture. So I added some eyelet backed by white fabric here and here. And on the back is just some fabric I had. And I used a tutorial done by Missouri Star Quilt Company to figure out how to machine stitch down the binding. I've always done it by hand, and so I was really happy to find a great technique to actually do it by machine. And actually, you know, sometimes doing it by machine, you have it all twisted or the stitching line doesn't fall in the right place, but this one looks really good. And you get mitered corners perfectly done. Very happy about that. And I used a walking foot for the actual stitching, the actual machine quilting part. Just so you know, I stitched each block here and it worked pretty well, I think. I matched all the intersections, all the corners of the squares. That was a kind of an issue for my first quilt, matching them up. But I think it turned out really well. Pleased about this one. Okay, so let me talk to you a little bit about my watercolor. Alright, so I got some new supplies. I got new supplies last week and then I started painting this week. I think that's how it happened. I got a new palette for my watercolor. This has 10 wells, I think. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, 10 wells and a big well in the middle. And this one is made out of porcelain with a plastic lid. And I got this off of Amazon. I actually ordered two palettes. One was a rectangular, basically a dinnerware, rectangular white porcelain tray. And I also ordered this 10 well, and they came and they were broken, completely shattered. So I contacted Amazon and they refunded and replaced. So I'm very happy about that. I'm still waiting for the rectangular palette to come. And I also got off of eBay from a seller in Arizona. Winsor & Newton paint, professional grade. Before I was just using just a few Winsor & Newtons. I only had primary colors and then I was using some student grade watercolor and I wasn't really pleased with the how translucent they were. So I thought it was time to upgrade so I can actually mix things, layer my painting. And I was watching Anna Mason on YouTube and she was using Winsor & Newton Professional, and I thought Okay, that's the one to get. I guess that one is a high quality, and a lot of other artists are using it, so I thought I'll try this one out. So I bought a lot of the colors I bought were based on what Anna Mason uses in her paintings, as well as Steve Mitchell from the Mind of Watercolor YouTube channel. A lot of her colors are like, this one is called Opera Rose. She has ultramarine blue. She recommends Winsor Lemon. I could not find that one in stock, so that one has to be made in another order, I guess. Steve Mitchell recommended Sepia because he mixes it with a lot of other colors and gives that natural feel, so I ordered Sepia. I don't think he uses Winsor & Newton that much. I think he uses, what's that other one? Jack Daniel? I think that's the one he uses. But I found Sepia and Winsor & Newton, so I'm going to try that one out. Oh yeah, she also recommends Payne's Gray, and I can see why. I like to use that one a lot, too. These watercolor brushes are Winsor & Newton University series. So I bought these probably back in the fall. I've had these for a while. Because I've always used artist brushes that were kind of on the economical side, I don't really know what to compare it to. But it's working for me. They're easy to clean. The bristles are nice and uniform. There's no stragglers. The handle seems to be not falling apart like some of the ones I've had, like the paint chipping. So far so good. So I used up my hot press paper, so I bought this off of eBay from a New York seller, and it's called Fluid Hot Press Finish Watercolor Paper. It's a 9x12, and this one is a block. I never used a block before. I've always used paper that I just got from Dick Blick and stretched it myself. But with a block, you don't need to stretch it because it has adhesive on two sides, so it doesn't need stretching. All you have to do is when you're done painting, you take a palette knife, run it along this side and up here, and it comes right off. So the painting I did was some dogwood. It's a branch of dogwood blossoms. And I used Payne's Gray mixed with Sepia for the gray, and Opera Rose mixed with I think I mixed Opera Rose with the crimson for the pink and the petals. And I used straight up sepia for the first layer on the branch, and then I followed it with sepia mixed with burnt sienna. The leaves, I believe I used olive green and permanent sap green. Yeah, I mixed those two together to make the green. And I'm using Anna Mason's approach to watercolor for this one, which is doing things in layers. That means setting down a very light wash initially and letting that dry, coming in with another one, setting the tone of the petals by showing the relationship with the branch or the leaves. So I basically left the dogwood blossoms alone for most of the painting process. But I did go back maybe two times to darken them just a slight bit to make them be more realistic in comparison to the darkness of the leaves and the branch. If I would have to change anything for this painting, I would probably go lighter on the branch because I came to a point where I thought the branch was really dark, but the blossoms don't seem dark enough, and I think if I added any more gray to the blossoms, they would be more of a gray blossom than a white blossom. So if I just kept that one a bit lighter, I would have been a little bit more happy with this painting. I was working on this painting, and then my sister comes and she really liked it, so she said, could you put a quote on it? And she likes this Bible verse, so I added the Bible verse to it, done in watercolor. So that's my finished piece. Well, thank you for joining me this Sunday afternoon. I hope the cold snap here in the Midwest and the eastern side of the United States is not getting too cold for you. We thought it was going to get down to zero last night, but it didn't, thank goodness. But it seems like the lake I live by is getting a nice thick layer of ice, so maybe my brother can go out ice fishing soon. He hasn't yet this year because it has been warm here in Michigan. And I have the show notes on my blog, of course. That is artandneedlework.com. And I also posted recently about my favorite YouTubers. So if you like to learn about your craft on YouTube, be it knitting or quilting, watercolor, or even carpentry, you can look on my blog post I just posted. You can find a new YouTube channel to subscribe to. And if you're interested in my crochet sweater progress, you can follow me on Instagram. It's Instagram. My username is Art and Needlework. And if you want to see my detailed process of making this crochet sweater, you can also check my notebook on Ravelry. My ID is needlestohook. Thank you very much for watching. Talk to you soon. To go into a little bit more about my crocheted sweater I'm working on. It is called the Garden Party Sweater, and it's designed by Marley Bird. This is the most updated version of the pattern I can find. Some of the people that made the sweater found some errors, so Marley Bird updated it. And let me just show you that it has hearts and a schematic in the back. Really helpful stuff. The thing I wanted to talk about is the gauge. And I wanted to talk about this because a lot of people were having a question about finding the gauge for this sweater that I saw on Ravelry. And I just wanted to go through this to go over how I find the gauge, my process of finding the right size, and things like that. So what I did was I looked at the gauge here, and it says 2 repeats in 8 rows equals 4 inches in shell lace pattern. And I referred to the chart back here, and I found out that 16 stitches equals 4 inches and 8 rows equals 4 inches. That helped me a little bit in finding out if my gauge matched. So I first started out with this gauge swatch, which was done with a size F hook, which is the cod 4 crochet hook for this pattern. And I got this gauge swatch and I measured it. I want to point out here that I soaked the swatch in cold water for about 10 minutes and then I laid it flat to dry. And then I took a measurement like that. I found out that my swatch was way too small. It wasn't even close to what the original design is. So I decided to move up a hook to size G. And I did this swatch. And I soaked it for 10 minutes and then I laid it flat to dry. And I'm still not matching the pattern's gauge. I am about 3/4 of an inch off both ways. So instead of 2 repeats in 8 rows equals 4 inches, like the pattern, I have 2 repeats in 8 rows equals 3.25 or 3 1/4 inches. So it's still smaller than the original. But that's okay because I like the way it looks and I want to keep it this way. I don't want to go up another hook size or I'm going to just make these stitches way too loose and not what I'm looking for. What I think is going on with this pattern is that when you're blocking it for a gauge swatch, it should actually be stretched a little bit because it is a lace design. And that's why I think a lot of people on Ravelry are having the same issue with the gauge. It should be stretched a little bit. I also want to point out here that I am probably getting the 3.25 over 4 inches due to the fact that I'm using this type of yarn. The pattern calls for roslin, which is a 90% cotton, 10% cashmere yarn. And this yarn here that I'm using is the Knit Picks Fingering Gloss, which is merino wool and silk. Cotton tends to be a sturdier type of fiber, and I was looking at the yarn that the pattern calls for, and it does look like a thicker, not as fluffy yarn. So it's probably going to get a larger gauge than what I'm using here, the gloss fingering. So that probably has something to do with my smaller gauge. Okay, the first thing I do is take a look at the back here. And the back width is 20 inches for the size 40 bust. I have circled here. I take that 20 inch measurement and I divide that by 4, which is the gauge for 2 pattern repeats. If you remember, 2 repeats equals 4 inches for the gauge. So 20 divided by 4 equals 5, 5 inches. I multiplied 5 by 16, which is the number of stitches in a 2-pattern repeat. So if you go back to the chart for that shell stitch and you count the number of chains, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, there's 8 chains for 1 repeat, so 2 repeats equals 16 chains. 16 chains equals 16 stitches. So that's where I get that number. So I multiply 5, which is 5 inches, by 16, the number of stitches in a 2-pattern repeat, and I wind up with 80. What is 80? I'll go to the pattern instructions to see how many stitches in the foundation chain are made for the back. And I see that it is 82. I won't turn it to that page because this is a commercial pattern and I do not want to give out too much information. But I can say that it is 82. So those 2 extra stitches were added to 80 to allow for the lace stitch pattern to be generated with multiples of 8 plus 2. It's just something to do with the stitch pattern. But I can see how those the 20 inches is arrived at. It is crochet 80 chains at the beginning. So I see the relationship between the pattern instructions and the schematic, which is a great first step. Now it is time to compare the size 48 bust to my special gauge, which is 3.25 inches for two pattern repeats and eight rows. I always like to ask myself these questions. What width for the back do I need? I need 20 inches. Which size has 20 inches? Answer, 40 inch bust size. What is my gauge? Answer, 16 stitches equals 3.25. Now that I know what math to do, 20 divided by 3.25. In other words, 20 inches divided by 3.25 will give me how many stitches for 1 inch. So I do 20 divided by 3.25 equals 6.15 da-da-da. Now I multiply that number by 16, which is my two pattern repeat, which makes the 3.25, and I get 98. I will round that to 98. Now, you have to ask yourself, what size in the pattern has 98 stitches for the back piece? How many chains do you start out with? And you give or take 2 stitches. The answer for me is the 48 inch bust size. Actually, it has exactly 98 stitches. Now, I did go and look at other parts of the schematic, like the length of the back, and the width of the sleeve, width of the front, all those other spots that I can figure out, to double check the compatibility of the 48 inch bust size in my special gauge of 3.25. After checking and double checking, I find that the 48 inch bust size will actually be the 40-inch bust size when I'm done with it, because my gauge here is smaller than the pattern's.